Here we go.
You just, you look great. this is Taxi for Himesh and Dan, take one.
Welcome to London. How's your time been, Dan? How are you enjoying London?
I've had the greatest time. I'm trying to move here.
Are you?
Yeah.
Why?
What do you mean, why?
Don't you live in LA?
Have you been to LA?
Yeah, I actually don't like LA.
I don't want to shit on LA.
I don't know why I said that.
But you need, it's an acquired taste. Yeah. Yeah, I love it here so much.
And have you been showing him around?
We met at a pub the other day.
Yeah, which and my children accosted you.
Exactly.
And so, yeah.
Where was that? Where was that pub?
Notting Hill.
Yeah, Notting Hill. Yeah,
that's a great place to take someone from out.
I know, but this man has a family.
Yeah.
So I am a lone ranger. I am a solo man in his...
Brady.
Late 20s. Yeah.
He's got an issue with the sound there.
You know, I have to make my way to your place.
Yeah.
I've had a lot of very fond memories in London. I lived here for a while in my early 20s. In fact, there's a story that made its way into the movie that I wrote for the three of us to reminisce on about having found a sex toy.
Do you think about the day we moved in?
Oh my God.
What did you find again?
I think I was 20 and I found an apartment and I was cleaning the apartment and I pulled the bed out from the wall and felt something thump behind the bed. And I didn't have my cleaning gloves on, but I thought it was the bottle of like cleaning solution and I went to reach for it. This is an inappropriate conversation, but I went to reach for it and I felt something phallic in nature kind of slip out of my hands. And I looked over the bed and it was a perfume bottle that someone had wrapped in a condom to, I suppose, enjoy themselves with.
Yeah.
A homemade dildo on the bed. And that was my first real London memory. And I've loved it ever since.
Such a terrible way of explaining why London's your favorite city in the world.
In their defense, those women had a reputation for being very messy and forgetful prostitutes.
Legends.
And Himesh, are you from London?
No, I'm from Cambridgeshire, like the middle of nowhere. It's such a contrast to how I grew up. When I go into central London, I have moments of going, I live here now. Yeah, it's very exciting.
I'm a Canadian. Most of growing up, we see London via film. I was one of 400 million people that have descended on Notting Hill and essentially terrorized the neighborhood ever since the film came out.
Oh, fucker!
But it did get me here.
Sorry, I'm so sorry.
There's a lovely digger over there and...
it's really beautiful.
I really like that forklift truck over there is really doing it for me.
All the sights and sounds of London that we're talking about,
yeah.
Right around here.
You set your movie here.
Really felt like a dream, especially as like a first film to have been given the access that I was given, and we just got to see the most amazing places, and it feels like a rare, strange privilege sometimes when you work in movies or TV because you have access to people and places that you would never normally get that kind of access to, like the museum and the gallery in Paris and this beautiful house that we shot in London and this gorgeous apartment in Paris. It was like, I don't know how I got here, but I'm grateful that I'm here.
Can you be in love with a couch?
When did you first become aware of this movie, read scripts? Like, what was your entry into it?
I'd say September, sort of the latter quarter of the year, the last year when we shot it. It didn't feel like an audition, really. It just felt like we were just sat around chatting. I think Ruth had already been cast, right?
Yeah.
And we spent most of it just
talking
about what I was going to wear to the Emmys, I think.
That was exactly it.
So that would have been actually, yes, early September.
Yeah.
And that times it.
It was a great suit, by the way.
Thank you very much.
Really, really good.
And we were like, oh, should we read the scene?
Yeah.
And we read the scene and had it, and I enjoyed it.
I think this is a beautiful thing. I think this is a beautiful, soulful thing you are offering us.
And I read about your inspiration behind it coming from your own life and stuff. Like, where was this idea coming from?
Over the past couple of years, some very important people and my dog passed away, and I found myself really examining my relationship to grief and what it means to me. And all I was getting after Schitt's Creek were opportunities to play the same character that I had just played, except I not to sound like a dick, but I felt like I had written that character as best as I could play it. So getting kind of variations on a theme that I didn't think were quite as exciting wasn't thrilling to me, and I wanted to do something very different, but I didn't know what that was. And so in this downtime after the show, the dust of the show had settled, I was really grappling with this idea of grief and what it meant to me and running away from it, and then eventually coming to a point where they couldn't run away from it anymore. And also exploring the concept of friendship, like adult friendships, that's what it's all about, I think, at the end of the day.
We built you the nest, and we sat on you for a year. It's time to hatch, my little puffling.
Something really lovely is that the friends have their own lives, that you're seeing some of it you're hearing about off camera, but they have their own things going on, and I love that. I love that they're like fully realized.
Completely. I mean, it's kind of what made me want to jump into this and play Thomas, you know, despite all the things you don't see, there was a complete human being there.
In terms of how you're playing that role, you're balancing like supporting your friend through something really hard, but also there's a level of like, oh, it's an opportunity. How does that like, how do you play that?
I think with something like that, it wasn't written as a sort of Machiavellian plan, you know? I mean, my whole thing with what was so beautiful about all of this was that it was so truthful, and that there probably is something very truthful to and honest about the idea of that at least opening a window, you know, somewhere in the back of your mind, whether you want it to or not. In those moments, like when they're watching TV and he tucks Mark in on the sofa, it wasn't like I was going, I have to play this in a way that he's like, maha, I'm in love with you again. We will be together. Yeah. Like, it was never like, it was like
Thomas leans in to kiss Mark, completely unconscious.
Yeah, he smells his forehead. It was always just, it's just a moment of tenderness, you know. And make of it what you will. What I love about all of this is that none of it's done obviously, none of it's done in a way that I think people might expect.
The other bit I thought was beautiful was the, I think it's right at the end in the Margate Gallery with
David Bradley.
Yes. He's not in loads of scenes, but every scene he's in is so, like, such a presence. He's so good.
I mean, he destroyed us in that funeral scene, time and again. I feel like we ran it, didn't we? We went straight from Caitlin's into his. Mm-hmm. We just ran that one after the other without cutting. Mm-hmm. And it was amazing for the two of them, Caitlin to do her, what she does, but then for David to come after and just completely broke our hearts. And I mean, no tear stick required.
What I wouldn't do to take your place, son.
If you want to know how to be a good actor, just surround yourself with really good actors.
I have to ask you about Celia Imrie, because I love her so much. And when she popped up on the screen, I was like, yes, Celia. Like, is she amazing?
She's absolutely amazing. And she's been so supportive. She came to set when she didn't have to. She like showed up just to cheerlead. She was so excited. And that made me feel so great.
I am, yeah.
Came to it. We had a little screening last night, showed up in the most sparkly shoes you've ever seen. We got along so well. And I think she had watched the show, and there was such a fondness that we had for each other in the beginning of the movie. And these moments when I actually needed her to be a little bit more stern, yeah. I kind of had to be like, I'm sorry, we can just.
The reputation for food in the UK to an international audience, terrible.
Is it?
Is that fair?
I don't know how fair that is necessarily. I think especially because it's a very multicultural culture. So you know, you've got like things that are perceived to be completely British, like pie and mash and fish and chips and all the healthy stuff. But then you've got so much food from around the world.
I feel like people's opinion on British food came from like the 70s.
Right.
When the palate was very different.
Okay.
Some of my favorite restaurants are in London. Some of my favorite food, I mean, Darjeeling, yeah.
So good.
It's a lovely place to spend a night. Oh, I love a nice roast at the Pelican. The Pelican in Notting Hill, great, excellent, excellent food.
We're in Old Street. There's a lot of good food around here.
Speaking of, Addis.
Addis.
Addis, A-T-I-S.
Oh, this.
Okay. That's a healthy option.
Oh, well, there you go. I've literally never heard of that.
Really?
There you go.
Or as the Brits call it, Attis.
Attis.
They make fun of me for saying Attis. Attis.
Or Attis. Attis.
I would say Attis.
Yeah, but I'll take that over this.
Attis.
You can understand why so many American people come here and adopt an accent. It's just out of a desperate need to sound nicer.
Does it sound nicer?
You don't sound, you think I think you American sound accents don't sound nice?
No, I'm not making that generalization on camera.
Do you think that we find American accents cooler?
Yeah, much cooler.
Right?
Because there's some words that we can't say.
Like what?
They sound stupid. Like if you say, I'm going to kick your ass.
Yeah, it's just no, not that's, as good. Yeah, no, it's
it
not, is
work.
It? Yeah. Yeah.
It's like, I'm going to kick your ass.
Yeah.
It works better. It feels, dunno. Doesn't.
I'm gonna kick your ass.
Ass getting kicked.
I don't think I could even say that with my own. I can't sell that line. No one will write that line for me.